Hey everyone, just wanted to record a quick preface to this episode. This episode is actually a serious discussion of topics the hosts wanted to sit down and chat about, and we don't really make a whole lot of jokes. It's about an hour and a half of us actually being serious about monkey cognition in an unedited, raw discussion format. If that's not really your thing, you can skip this episode, but I think you should give it a listen anyways, because we all value your feedback and we want to create content that you actually want to listen to. And, you know, you might end up enjoying it. With that being said, though, we sent this episode out to patrons early, as we always do, and I wanted to include some of their feedback in the beginning. The indigenous hunter-gatherer tribe in the Amazon rainforest we mentioned in this episode are the Piraha people, and we are by no means a resource on them. If you would like more in-depth and nuanced analyses of their lives and language, there are many good resources online that are not us, such as Simon Roper's video on Piraha phrenology. There's also at least one occasion where the technology employed by the Piraha people is referred to as primitive, which has a heavy colonial connotation. I hope the context conveys that that was clearly not our intention, but as the host most adjacent to anthropology, I probably should have caught that during the discussion itself. A more accurate term with less baggage would probably be pre-pastoral, as that is their mode of living. With that being said, please continue to provide us with feedback on this episode. If you loved it and want us to be serious more often, or if you found it trite and boring, either way, just let us know. But thanks for listening, and enjoy.
Why did you start it off by making a stupid noise?
What else does Austin do on this podcast but make stupid
noise? It's just whenever we want to come up with a good starting point, we just cut
to folks, that. Welcome to episode 27. It's Monkey Mortality, baby. You've been waiting for it. We're here to deliver it.
We're going to answer the deep-seated philosophical questions that none of you asked and none of you care to know the answers to. About monkey morality, spirituality, and the concept of consciousness. I hope you're ready to buckle the fuck in, because we don't do a serious episode, like, ever. So, this is going to be real. We're going to do philosophy. I'm going to read
you. This is a Greg episode.
I think somebody...
Jaden asked for this.
Jaden, Bird asked for us to do a serious episode, like, 6 months ago. And we were like, it's coming in the pipeline. Yeah.
We never did it. But Jaden specifically asked for this, and then they will not listen. They don't listen to the podcast. So we're just doing right. This. Yeah, we're just doing this. So, okay.
Yeah, do you want me to start out? I don't know.
I would like to, I'm going to steal from Big Soy Naturals here, and I'm going to give everybody an overview of what exactly we're going to talk about before we do.
Okay. All right. Yeah, sounds good.
Lovely. So, steal.
There are, we love thievery. There are a couple main points I would like to touch upon in this episode, everyone. So I think the biggest one is do primates of any type, we're going to specifically try and focus on great apes, have a concept of morality, and do they execute on that? I would like to talk about the connection between morality, consciousness, and spirituality. It's been touched upon a couple times, is like, could a primate have a sense of spirituality? And then I guess really just intelligence and linguistics and how much language you need to actually have a functioning set of morals, or a functioning set, really, I guess, of spiritual beliefs. So those are the big ones. And then I guess yeah, Austin, why don't you lead off with the Kanzi thing?
Yeah, for sure. Here's where my sort of area of expertise comes in. Kanzi the bonobo, great guy, right? We all know him. The funny little guy. He talks with his computer to his caretakers.
Yeah, you all know him. Stephen Hawking of the Great Apes.
Sure, you could say that, I guess, maybe.
Redacted.
Take it out.
2 minutes and 40 seconds.
Remove it. No, I don't know. It's probably fine. Anyways. So yes, Kanzi the bonobo was originally a part of one of those monkey language experiments, right? Like Nim Chimpsky, but they were like, hey, maybe these great apes don't have the capacity for, you know, vocal communication. Like, they just don't have the throat for it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And which is, like, one of the, like, highlights of human evolution is that our larynx is broken into two separate chambers, which allows us to make the complicated noises we do.
Yeah. And
it's also higher, right? Ours are higher than most other apes or lower? Like, our voice box is in a different spot. Our larynx is in a different spot. I think, I want to say it's higher.
It's low.
Lower?
I think it's lower.
It's lower.
Huh. But yeah, you know, Neanderthals had similar thing going on, but I don't know if you've ever seen that video of a reconstructed Neanderthal voice. It just sounded like the worst British woman you've ever heard.
They were very shrill.
Top of her lungs, yeah.
Very shrill.
Yeah, they were very, very shrill. They were in a different... they were going a different way with it, but they were able to talk.
As soon as I saw that, like, video, I, like, it proved the theory that I always knew, like, in my heart, that
the British people are
Neanderthals, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, no, I mean, it is true, but, so essentially, this is their theory. They're like, all right, well, if he can't speak, like, the way humans speak, maybe if we gave him, like, a sort of device to physically interact with, he could speak with us that way. And so... The Great Ape Trust, the two main players here are, I think, Sue Savage Rumbaugh and William L. Fields, also known as Bill Fields, which will be, he'll be referred to as from here on out. But, and they got a little freaky with Kanzi. Not in that way, but essentially, they had him...
Me and Greg immediately made the worst faces at Austin.
They got a little, like, weird, like, almost an unhealthy attachment. I wanted to say parasocial, but that doesn't really make sense in that scenario. They just got really, like, invested in Kanzi as an individual ape rather than as a, like, scientific experiment, you know? And so there was many crazy things he could do, you know, just like Coco the gorilla, you know, he could combine unique things to get, you know, kind of food that he wanted. He could see a concept and pick the closest symbol on his board and it would make a word. But, you know, as we've spoken about before, really all of these language experiments went down the shitter and got disproved one way or another. Savage Rumbaugh, it's hyphenated, so I guess I could say either, but I'll just call her Savage Rumbaugh. There was a lot of complications where they were basically overfeeding Kanzi because he would just keep pressing, like, the buttons for this kind of food, and they'd be like, oh, you're so smart, give him a, you know, whatever food he wanted. And he sort of, he definitely abused that, and, you know, got into this concept of, like, who's training who, so to speak, where basically a lot of dissenters or detractors from this research said, he's basically just playing you guys. Like, he's giving you what you want to hear, and you're rewarding him with treats, right? But regardless of that, over time, Bill Fields and Sue became super convinced that not only could Kanzi, you know, communicate perfectly with this little lexicon board, or lexigram, sorry, that they also became convinced that he could utter simple phrases in English. Like, he would, like, point at something and go, like, oh, and they'd be like, oh, he just said over there. So I'm starting to think they were going a little bit insane.
They have a bit of a confirmation bias on their hands.
Yeah, absolutely confirmation bias, but... the craziest thing came through, and this actually sparked a debate on, like, ape morality, right, is a principal investigator that was basically in charge of giving funding to the lab, right, came in and was discussing with Sue something about funding. I don't remember the specifics, and I don't know if the story that's been retold has ever gone into that. I don't think it matters. Basically, what happened is the argument started getting heated, and the PI started yelling at Sue, who Kanzi sees as, you know, like a mother, because they were really, like, unhealthily close. Like, the kind of close that maybe a mother and a child would have, or a pet and its owner would have, really not...
The Travis connection, right.
And Kanzi started freaking out because he saw this, like, random person just yelling at, you know, his mom. And so he allegedly, this is where it gets really heavily into the allegedly part. Okay. Mm-hmm. Allegedly, he calls Bill over and tells him on the lexigram, "You need to bite that woman or I am going to bite you." And so he says to Kanzi, this is, you know, we're humans. We have cultural standards. You know, we have laws. I cannot bite this woman because of a disagreement. And so Kanzi gets mad at him. And apparently the next time they're walking Kanzi back to his little enclosure, he's in the hallway, which, insane building design. I don't know why you let the ape just walk through the hallway and, like, just trust him through that.
Yeah, what?
Apparently, according to Bill, he stopped right before his enclosure, turned around, bolted down the hallway, kicked down his door, and bit off his thumb. And then he just went back.
Bit off his own thumb?
No, bit off Bill's thumb, as he promised to do. Yeah.
Oh.
As he promised to do earlier. And so, essentially, Bill said he was very upset with Kanzi and wouldn't go to see him or talk to him for 8 months until he apologized, which is just so fucking petty and hilarious. Like, I'm not talking to the monkey until he says sorry. you teach him language, and then you expect him to apologize. But, you know.
Okay.
Eventually, at the end of the story, apparently Kanzi goes up to him and apologizes at some point. They cry, hug, make up, whatever. Basically, the debate here is Kanzi had a, you know, moral rule set here. This woman is yelling at my mom. You need to punish her. And if you don't punish her, I'm going to punish you. What does that mean? Personally, I think he's bullshitting and insane. They all are kind of went insane. They lost funding. He went to, like, an actual sanctuary and place that takes care of him now. Kanzi, that is.
Not Bill.
He's much better now.
Bill, too.
On the street.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, yeah, what do you think? Assuming this is true, what do you think?
Well, I think it's a really good place to start because we're kind of debunking something that's clear. This sounds like it's clearly bullshit.
Yeah, it does sound like bullshit.
This doesn't sound like that. If it's true, it is the most astoundingly intelligent act that an ape has ever done in captivity.
Yeah, and I think, like, fundamentally, when something like this happens in science and is corroborated, and is it, like, scientists, like, I don't believe in, like, the myth that scientists are morally and ethically pure, and that science as itself is an ethically pure thing that will always function correctly. But I do believe that some of the institutions in our scientific community have the capability of a discovery is presented to the community, and then the community debates it, the community experiments on it, and they move it forwards or they debunk it. The fact that, how long ago has this happened, Austin? When did Kanzi's experiment happen?
This was, it had to be in 2000 to 2010. It was somewhere in that decade.
Yeah. So in the past, in the past decade or two.
Well, it was 2 decades ago, technically, but give or take. But
past decade or two, no experiment, no scientific inquiry has been able to A, replicate this behavior, replicate this experiment, which is so important, by the way, y'all. When y'all look at scientific scientific results, replication is key. Because if you can't replicate it, then it's just a fluke. And whether or not it happened or not, it doesn't matter anymore. Because a fluke is a fluke. It has to be replicated, and a decade or two of just consistent research, further and further proof that great apes do not have the capacity for language. Be it through, like, these like experiments where it is just like we try to teach an ape how to use a board, or we like literally look in their brains and recognize they lack the components that we have that make it capable us for us to use language. Yeah.
Because is Kanzi the only major study with using like a lexigraph board?
A lexigram? I believe the same Great Ape Trust tried it with a couple other bonobos. I can't remember.
The same type of effect where they figured out the food button? Because that's... Like, I wouldn't call that... I believe that...
Kanzi was the smartest ape that they had.
Smartest. Yeah. The others were bonobos. Like, this doesn't seem like a well-designed experiment. If you're going to do it, it needs to all be chimps. Or all be bonobos.
I think they only used bonobos, but I'm not sure on that. Let me see. There was a big falling out where... basically, the research seemed so, like... interesting and novel when it first came out that Franz de Waals, we've talked about him a couple of times, was actually a big supporter and was like, this is huge, this is great. But as it became more and more obvious that they weren't replicating this with other, you know, bonobos, and that it was like either through trickery of this particular bonobo or just like preference or playing favorites, essentially, you know, the human caretakers having way too much of a confirmation bias with this one specific bonobo. Basically, over time, the Sioux, the Savage Limbaugh, became less and less interested in sort of proving herself scientifically and more just like arguing that, like, you know, you wouldn't understand the connection me and Kanzi have, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, Franz de Waals was like, hey, you need to distance yourself from Kanzi and like think of this scientifically, take a more scientific approach. And she blew that off, which is why basically her findings were more or less discredited and they moved on from this experiment. And honestly, I don't think they've ever tried it again just because... You know, they might try it again in the future, but I don't think anyone's going to try it again just because I don't think anyone's willing to put themselves out there and fund something like this again, given that they've all been failures, more or less.
Okay. Well, okay. So, I guess from here, with that wonderful anecdote about Kanzi being a fucking freak,
it's hard to find out if he actually bit his thumb off, because I can't find pictures of him missing any thumbs. But anyways, continue.
Oh, do we not even have the...
Yeah, what the fuck?
Basic material evidence?
What the fuck do you mean? He we don't know?
There's barely any pictures of him online, and the few that he has, you can't really see his hands. So, I don't know. This might... Okay, this is, like, so like anecdotal. Bullshit. Yeah.
All right, very okay. Anecdotal. So, I think a good place to start now is talking about the building blocks, or whatever the fuck you want to call it, the creation of a morality system. So, I've been doing a lot of research, everyone. And the main thing that I came across, to not make this take 4 hours to explain, is humans are social creatures. We, especially in our earliest stages of existence, relied on a community to survive, to raise young, to find food, to hunt when we reach that level of development. All of these things are communal activities. And the research kind of points to the remaining groups of people around the world who still exist in this hunter-gatherer lifestyle. The main one being the San people of like Southwest Africa. They still exist in this very, very, very primitive, like compared to us, way of living. They hunt, they gather, they live communally, they raise children communally, and they essentially share the majority of their resources. The morality system that exists there is much more based on survival than, say, the way we live, where there's a lot of luxury involved in our lives. So the morals we have reflect that. So at a very, very base level, most morals are like... I'm going to help this person when they don't have enough food because they'll help me when that is me, because that will be me. Like, that is the understanding that they have. It's like, that person's struggling right now. If I don't help them when I'm struggling, they're not going to be inclined to help me.
Or helping me because they're anymore.
Exactly. So it is a very self-serving thing, but it does benefit the community. It's the same, that same set of moral rules kind of governs the reason why those groups of people, they raise children communally, because a mother cannot do everything to raise an infant and still be out gathering or be out like hunting.
Hey, Greg, I don't want to cut you off. You might talk about this later, but does this at all tie into why early humans were observed taking care of their elderly? Like, is this more of an empathy thing? Yeah, okay. Do you have something flipped? Okay, yeah.
So, well, I mean, just to kind of touch on that is... Sorry, voice crack. So that those same communities, they do have, like, the myth of, like, you before medicine, people died at, like, 40 is not true. Like, that is very much a myth. It might not, it wouldn't have been as prevalent, but it happens pretty regularly. People live into their 70s or 80s. So in these communities, they do have elderly people who can no longer perform the tasks they performed as young people. They can't hunt. They can't really gather. But they don't get abandoned. They aren't killed. They aren't, like, you know, just left to die. They are taken care of by the community. And the best that can be pieced together by sociologists is it is a form of thanks. It is a form of thanks and a sense of moral duty, but not one that we can... Not one that's comprehensible. It does. It seems very unique to primates, to apes. It's not something that's observed outside of apes, and I can't remember what family elephants are in. Elephants do it.
Yeah.
Elephants do it, and elephant-related animals will do it. They're related to canines. I know that because it's also observed in wolves. But it's not observed in big cats.
Oh.
So, like, wolves, canines will take care of the elderly ones in the pack. They're not to a point, not to the same point that we will, but they will take care of the elderly in the pack. They won't shun them. Big cats tend to do the opposite, where they are left. But yeah, primate, it's very interesting. And in the course of my research, I read most of an article here from the Department of Anthropology in Zurich by a Dr. Judith Burkhart, Rachel Brueger, and Carol Scheich. Very fucking kraut names.
My favorite part of reading, like, academic journals is just the names. It's so fun reading the names, just imagining how they could be pronounced.
And so there is an excerpt. The excerpt that's actually in the chat that you guys can see is actually from this article. But main takeaway, because I want to talk about that specific excerpt, but the main takeaway is that this behavior, this, like, caretaking behavior, this, like, communal sense of morality is observed in monkeys. But it's most strongly observed what the fuck is it called? Calotrichidae? Is that right? New World monkeys? It's New World monkeys.
Yeah.
So this behavior is actually observed more often in New World monkeys than it is in great apes and all Old World monkeys. So these kind of moral constructs of working as a community. Go ahead.
Yeah, correction. It's actually specifically... marmosets, tamarins, lion tail. Like, it's a specific family of New World monkeys.
Yeah.
So interesting. Yeah. I didn't know that.
So it's actually... it's very... It's observed in them very specifically. That is in the closest mirror image to how primitive people would have lived. However, they did this study, which if I scroll up, I'll figure it out.
I'll have a bit of input on this really quick. So as a primatologist, basically I know that from just speaking to other primatologists who are much more qualified than me, field work is very hard. Like, you can spend weeks just trying to find a fucking monkey in a jungle. So when studies like this say, like, it's mostly observed in this family, it could either mean in captivity, or it could just mean this behavior could be common in a lot of other primates, but we just can't watch them long enough to see it. And just so happens that, you know, maybe one person who was studying marmosets and stuff specifically happened to, you know, catch those behaviors and write about it. Yeah. So there's a big gap of information for specific species, which is why it's sometimes good to specialize, you know. But yeah, anyways, continue.
So I found the part that I was thinking about. So they did these tests, and they did them obviously on a person, on some of the members of that family that you're Calotrichidae, what the fuck they're called, and chimps. And the test was essentially like it's a morality test. So for people, the test was, it's like literally a fill out bubble test where they're talking about, would you give money in this situation? And they perform the test twice. First test, that's it. It's the questions. Second one, there is like iconography on the page of watching eyes.
It's a little scary, but yeah.
Yeah. So in the human test, it increased the amount of money people would give in certain situations because you're being watched. That's the idea, is you're being watched. So you're doing something for the good of the community because you know you'll get something in return. Now, humans have this ability innately without the watching eyes thing. So they're doing it out of their own sense of morality. I don't know how the fuck they did this test. I'm not reading this whole fucking thing. So they did it with games for the monkeys. So certain species of monkeys, specifically those like tamarins, those small monkeys, they also would perform those tasks without the watching eyes of the community. Chimps, however, would not. So unless the chimp was being watched by other chimps, the chimp would not engage in moral behavior. The idea behind this kind of is that humans in their primitive state, these marmosets, are cooperative breeders, meaning that it's the mother doesn't do anything when they have an infant. They cannot work. They cannot perform the duties necessary for survival. Whereas a chimp, you know, they're putting the baby on their back pretty quick, and they're still picking shit up and eating it. Mm-hmm. Am I correct? Right, Austin?
Yeah. No,
So they're not...
Quick rebound.
Yeah, so they're not cooperative breeders, whereas humans, it takes time to raise that child. And in these smaller monkeys, it takes time to raise that child. So they think that that might be the spark for morality, so that in species where, like, cooperative breeding is important, which it's also important to note that the things I said before, elephants and wolves, are also cooperative breeders. The community raises the young. So they think that that might be like the earliest spark for a morality system. However, there's also tests that show that chimps might. So they did another study, which it's in here. I'm not fucking finding it. Where they essentially would show videos to chimps of other chimps being killed, whether it be by hunters or other chimps. And
they got chimp live leak? That's fucking
yes.
up.
And so this is important because this is going to be specific to infants, to young. So when the chimps were shown videos of other adult chimps being killed, whether by humans, hunters, other chimps, they would show a reaction, a negative reaction, to show disapproval. However, they did not get excited. They wouldn't get excited so much as they would be disapproving of it. However, among the little monkeys and these chimps, these great apes, when they were shown footage of an infant being killed, the reaction is very, very visceral. They apparently get very, very excited, very angry. Like they kind of freak out, which these researchers believe that. I mean, this is a moral. It's do not harm young, that like the infants are not to be touched. And that's about the only thing scientifically proven that we can show. Like a chimp has a moral on this. This is a moral of theirs, is you shouldn't be killing the babies. Mm-hmm. Which obviously, like, humans would have the exact same thing.
Yeah. I think we absolutely do observe this in humans. I'm almost certain we've done these exact same experiments. And we've seen that humans find baby murder, infanticide, to be much more viscerally disturbing than any other kind of murder. Also, really quick, am I super quiet?
You seem okay to me.
Okay, my
way. Yeah, it's fine. We can fix it in post if it's bad, but yeah. I guess I think something that's interesting here is how often senses of, you know, morals and altruism are tied into reproductive success. And there's this concept that altruism is born from an evolutionary instinct to persevere. So, like, sometimes altruism is seen in animals that aren't typically known to be advanced or smart, where it's basically hypothesized that by being, like, selfless, you know, sacrificing oneself to save another, for example, or a younger, for example, it is a evolutionary drive to do this because you are sacrificing yourself to ensure the survival of your species. And it comes down to altruism being, you know, an instinct that is hardwired from evolution, from survival on a grander scale than just an individual. And so that's definitely something that plays into these discussions where, you know, maybe do humans even have altruism? Is it just, you know, that evolutionary drive?
I wonder if...
But is that evolutionary drive, does that count as altruism,
that's,
though?
That's the exact question I'm about to ask you.
Like, at what point can we draw the line?
Here's the thing. I want to challenge us really quickly to separate us as human beings and our specific wants and our specific morality from chimpanzees, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this evolutionary instinct, can this be considered morality? Because if we... I would think what would be much more interesting to discover or to figure out about a chimp, or a potential, like, moral chimp. If a chimp would hold a moral code, or rather, if this instinct was not something that related to us so deeply, would we ever consider it morality? Right? If chimps developed, like, moral codes that we fundamentally did not understand or agree with as moral, I think it would be almost... it would be very, very hard for any of us to accept that this is a morality system, right? And I think this is one of the really important things to always hold when you are studying the natural world, which is we cannot impose ourselves on it, or because we will skew the results.
Yeah, I think that's probably the most difficult thing to do in these situations, because... like, it is hard to draw that line. Like, you do hit a point, eventually, science is no longer applicable. You have to be philosophical and say, okay, well, does a genetic drive to do a certain thing, how is that not morality? Or how is it?
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, don't murder. There's a reason societies of humans all around the world, at a very base level, have the same code of laws. Don't murder, don't steal. Mostly those two things. Don't murder, don't steal. Like, those are very, very important things to human psychology. They also seem relatively important to the rest of the great apes and monkeys in general.
Mm-hmm.
It's an impossible question, I think, to ask. I think we're going to hit a lot of those in this episode where we can speak on a bunch of different things, but it's... at the end of it, it's not a question that could be answered unless I could get a monkey in front of me speaking English and telling me what it thinks.
Which would be scary, so we're not going to do
should
that.
Be.
Yeah.
Be so
Caesar, go home.
Of course, the flip side of like this little question I've just asked of us is, are like what you were just pointing out, Greg, are these evolutionary instincts that we kind of have as human beings that we observe in like every single culture, don't murder, is that even a moral system alone? And I think when we look at it like that way, I don't think any of us would sit here and say the evolutionary instinct in the human being to not murder is not a system of morals. It is, I mean, actually, I don't want to speak for you. Maybe you disagree with me. Maybe you think that is enough to become a system. But
what are morals, I guess?
This is what it comes down to.
I personally, and I think this might just be my personal philosophy on this, I would err on the side of saying yes, that is. Because I think humans are, I don't want to be a Homo sapien exceptionalist, I guess, on that. Like, I don't think that, quite honestly, we are not that far removed from that. Mm-mm. From that very, very prehistoric, primitive way of existence. So I wouldn't say that it's not. I would say that it is a system of morals in itself, because it isn't so simple as don't murder. Like, there are a lot of reasons you might, or you might want to, that you still would refrain from, because it is not acceptable personally to you to do that.
I have a question. So let's assume that the Kanzi story was made up, which it probably is.
Mm-hmm.
So this guy, Bill absolutely. Fields, is projecting a human morality onto this bonobo, Kanzi.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I guess, what does that reveal about us, that a system of, you know, like, retaliation and, like, punishment is what he would consider to be, like, an emergence of morality in an ape?
Oh, that's a very interesting question.
Well, I think we're an incredibly violent species, period. Like, I think chimps are probably the closest thing to as violent as we are on a species level. But I really, like, for all of the horrific physical violence a chimp can produce, they are nowhere near as violent as us. Like, there is a reason that Homo sapiens have expanded across the globe and chimps have not.
Yeah.
And at the base level, when pre-human, pre-Homo sapien, like, there the competition there is... Both of us were efficient in what we did, but we were efficient in a different way.
Yeah.
I think the human bar of morality might honestly be lower. If morality does exist among apes or among primates in general, I think the human bar might be lower, and that might be part of why we are so successful. Like, we are much more driven to kill for what we want, even with the embedded, like, code of we shouldn't.
And one other thing that I think is always super important to mention when it comes to human violence is our institutionalization of violence.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Is the way we build up systems which are mm-hmm. designed to be violent in order to uphold codes which we ascribe moral value to. You know, when we talk about the state's monopoly of violence, these are the questions we are grappling with fundamentally.
We've invented forms of violence chimps can't even comprehend.
That's truly crazy. So far, truly. Like,
the
there has been
know what gaslighting is. That's crazy.
There has been no more successful form of violence than the human form on this planet, period. For all of the physical violence nature has evolved in all species across all families of the tree. Like, human violence is quite notable and might be a case where I could go, okay, human exceptionalism is on par here, is Q here, because
there's something exceptional about us.
There is something
we are different.
insanely different about the way we conduct violence and the way we rationalize it in ourselves. And you have to ask the follow-up to that is, okay, are we so violent because of our intelligence or in spite of it? Because a chimp's capacity for violence physically outstrips us by a fucking mile.
Yeah.
But they lack the intelligence factor, I guess. Yeah. To kind of...
I think you're answering your question.
To utilize it, right? Yeah. Like, to utilize it for more than just personal gain on a very small scale.
Yeah, I do think humans are violent because they're, like, more capably violent because of their intelligence. I think it is the reason that I think the same way that we observe humans have tool use because mm-hmm. they are capable of constructing those abstract ideas mm-hmm. because we have systems of language, systems mm-hmm. of information sorting and gathering. I think the same systems that allow us to be tool users allow us to be capable, like, you know, deliverers of violence.
The thing is, though, you have to ask, I guess, in addition and also as a counterpoint to what you're saying is, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. do we develop those mechanisms as competition against other, like, a competition against other primates? Is that why it would start, or does it start due to an outside the family influence? Does that make sense?
Link, I think, I don't exactly know what field he's in, but Pinkerton, I think he's a mm-hmm. Linguist. He's a maybe some kind of anthropologist. Pinkerton describes the development of language in humans and how it fits into our understanding of evolution. Our development of language was to fulfill something he coined, I think, the cognitive niche.
Mm-hmm.
Like, when we look at creatures and how we evolve, we are all looking for a niche to succeed in, to thrive in. We're trying to specialize in order to most, like, effectively further our own species. Pinkerton's theory was that, or is, I don't think he's dead. Pinkerton's theory is that the development of language was to fulfill a cognitive niche because we recognized... Or because humans needed to close the gap between mm-hmm. the animal kingdom, between nature, which was, I don't want to say nature because we are part of nature, right? It's important that we recognize that humans are a part of nature right now. Like, humans needed to compete effectively. So we developed language. We developed a cognitive ability that would outstrip our opponents, basically, in the wild.
Yeah. Huh.
Yeah, no, that's actually...
Like, because we also, at the same time, we also know, like, the oldest tools we can find of us are generally, like, hammer. Like, a multi-use tool, but mainly to bash someone's head in. We immediately developed things that were weapons.
I wouldn't even be so cynical in that, because I think, like, what a lot of, like, animals can do that we can't, is, like, take a hard piece of food and crack between their teeth to get the good shit inside.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We need a tool to break it open. But yeah, I think there's a little bit of a danger there when we say the hammer is, like, a violent tool fundamentally. You know, I think we are prescribing its usage and its necessity to our survival. You know,
I would argue that, though, like, we're so fundamentally violent that if it's, and not to bias myself into this, I'm not saying I'm doing this
yeah, uh-huh.
to make the point, but if it's my first thought as, like, this is a multi-use tool, who's to say that it's not also the first thought of an early human? That, maybe. Oh, I can use it to smash open a shell and also a rival's, like a rival's head. Like,
yeah. I mean, I don't doubt that they got there eventually, Austin.
I guess something that is different is this is the most basic form of tool that is found, like, basically displayed being used in other primate species too. Like,
mm-hmm.
for example, I believe in October, or it might have been November's publication of the Primatology Journal, American Journal of Primatology. There was a study that says the first report of tool use in captive crested capuchin monkeys has been discovered, and it was a capuchin named Mateo cracking open some nuts with a rock.
You just so, like me.
Yeah. I think it is interesting that we haven't really seen any other primates take the logical step of, if I can break open nuts and, you know, coconuts with this shit, I can break open someone's head.
But chimps will use sticks to hit each other, right?
Well, yeah, that
but
is...
Chimps will okay, improvise yeah, is, a weapon.
They will, they absolutely will do that, and they will use it pre-planned as well to, they'll use spears, makeshift spears, to poke
they do stab halibut
monkeys to death, I think.
They do stab?
I'm not sure if it's, yeah, basically, they just, like, they jam it into the little red monkeys until they die, basically.
That's horrifying, but
yeah,
makes sense. Uh-huh. So evolutionarily, oh, hold on. Okay, Chandra, you go first. I have an evolution question for Austin.
I was just saying, I think gravity,
mm-hmm.
force, inertia mm-hmm. is. It's such a fundamental part of physics, right? Even today, inertia, force, these things, I can't blame or want to ascribe violence to a primitive species figuring out how to use force first, that being their first ability to utilize a tool. You know,
fair enough. So I think that ties into what I want to ask is, mm-hmm. so Homo sapiens, we're what? Like, officially, Homo sapiens are like about 1 million years old, as our current definition of what a Homo sapien is.
Let me get an exact figure.
Yeah, give me an exact, because I have a good question. I think
a million might be a little too
old.
I believe I don't
think we're much. Yeah,
it's 300,000 years.
So what was right before that?
There was a lot of, like, we had a lot of human ancestors. Like, there were a fucked, like, there wasn't one.
But what's the most recent one to Homo sapiens? Do we know? Is that, like, a question we can answer? Is Cro-Magnon man a separate species of person?
They say it would be Neanderthals, but it was sort
they're
of
not
like a,
linear.
But, like, they also, yeah, it's not linear. I don't know if any of this is linear. I believe Homo heidelbergensis mm-hmm. is our current best guess, but okay. It also says people, basically, we don't know. It was a lot of convergent, divergent evolution. Yeah. It could have came from any of the fucking species, basically.
And heidelbergensis was around for a while, from what I understand. Like, they were around for longer than we've been around currently. Right?
Yeah.
And so, like, at least. I know that we've done a lot more extensive mapping of what a person is compared to, like, what a chimp is, right? Current chimp. What's its most recent ancestor? Because they just haven't been chimps for 5 million years. They clearly have been moving towards current chimp. What is pre-chimp? Do we have, like, a chimp ancestor that would equate to, like,
I wouldn't be super confident that chimps have, like, because humans have very rapidly evolved. I think we've had kind of what I think a lot of people call a chaotic evolution. Our shit has been, we've had some really major drastic changes to what we are.
Very rapidly.
And they have been very rapid, which is a little bit outside the norm for evolution.
But what I think I'm getting at is, okay, so we know that. So we know that some smaller monkeys and smaller primates and smaller apes, they know to use a tool. Like, we've seen it in most of them. They will take something and smash something open. Mm-hmm. Or use a rock to do whatever. We know that they're doing that. A good amount of apes and primates have shown this. Chimps, as far as I know, are the only ones that we've ever witnessed utilizing a tool that is purpose-built to be a weapon, right?
And of course, depends on your definition of tool, because, like, but weapons specifically, I think chimps are the only one.
So, my question is, and it's obviously you can't be compared to the Homo line, because they're what, pan?
Yes.
Pan something?
Chimps are pan troglodytes.
Okay. At what point do we have an idea of, for us as humans, at what point the tool use spiraled out of control, to be quite honest? Because it clearly spiraled out of control at some point. So, like, do we have a theory on, there might be a tipping point for something like a chimp where the tool use will spiral out of control and then the evolution has to catch up?
I don't want to say this with confidence. I feel like agriculture is kind of a really big thing we point at.
But we were hunter-gatherers. We were very...
Hunter-gathering is not agriculture.
Yes, but we were very societally complex. So So what is the thing where the tool use kind of spirals out of control to the point where, like, you can go from what a chimp is to a hunter-gatherer to a farmer? Like, and I guess, like, what's the tipping point
if we can think of the middle there?
Yeah, like, so what do we have an idea of if there is a tipping point for, like, oh, okay, so once the chimp figures out that not only can I use a stick to poke things, but if I sharpen the stick, I can keep reusing the stick. Like, connections.
It's hard to say, because Homo habilis was the first human ancestor, we think, to start using stone tools.
Mm-hmm.
And there's been a couple of species since then. And I guess the thing with chimps is we just haven't really seen new species evolve from chimps. Yeah. Like, they got into a niche and they've sort of stuck to it. And I could be wrong about this, but to my knowledge, I think, like, the only thing we know for sure is that, like, there's chimps, and then before that, there was a common ancestor. Oh my god, there was a common ancestor between humans and chimps, which we know nothing about. Mm-hmm. So I think chimps have been around for, like, a while, and they haven't changed. And so yeah. There's no real, like...
So there hasn't been a lot of speciation.
Inclination, yeah. And there's no inclination that they're going to, like, suddenly enter the fucking Stone Age.
I think the really frustrating answer is that the evolution has to come first. The mutation has to come first. And then the tool use, and then the advancements will come.
I wonder what effect we've had.
It's hard to, like, pinpoint, like, what exactly changed that made Homo habilis suddenly be able to, like, was it born, like, obviously born from a need, but, you know, what changed in them physiologically that just made them, you know, err towards that more often? Because we've seen with chimps that there's social learning of tools, where chimps that don't know how to use tools, you put them in a jungle with a big pile of tools and, like, say just like stone tools and a bunch of nuts that need to be cracked. Give them like 20 years, probably won't figure it out. But tribes of chimps, I guess that's not really the right word.
Troops of chimps
that already have had the knowledge of tool use, like, sort of passed around socially for who knows how long, can figure that out, because they've been passing that information back and forth to each other. So it's a matter of, was our evolution influenced by social evolution, or was it the other way around? Does that make sense?
Like, genetic influence pushing us.
Was it genetic that pushed us to learn how to use these things?
So what was Homo sapiens' main competitor? Because we didn't originate in the same area that chimps do. We originated further north, right? Like, it would have been baboons? Like, would have been the main, like, primate competition?
Well, I think our main... I guess if we're talking before...
Outside of predation, like, when humans evolved, period, like, obviously, the out-of-Africa theory is not so much a theory, but a fact. Like, we know where-ish we came from. What is the main primate that lives there that's not us? Baboons?
I think it's less of a question of pinpointing exactly what other primate was there, so much as what environmental circumstances pushed this niche to need to be filled.
Yeah.
Well, that's why I would ask, because, like, if it's a baboon.
Yeah. The great apes were already filling a niche, but you got to think, great apes are competing with ourselves, more or less.
And, like, we existed within that ecosystem for a very long time. Like, the majority of our history, we interacted primarily, our main food gathering niche would have been what the other great apes were also going after as their food source. So, like, what a baboon would be eating, what a baboon does eat in the highlands of Ethiopia, would have been the same general food sources that a proto-human would also have been trying to obtain. Fucking grubs, berries, like, shit that grows or lives on the ground, and you don't need a stick to kill, right? So is the tool use more of a reaction to the fact that actually we're dog shit at that, and we need to now outcompete something that's good at that niche, like a baboon, where now we have to, okay, we need to develop tool use because baboon's not going to go try and kill an elephant, but we can try. Is it more of that?
I think it's a huge complex of factors that stem from the environment, and I think it's impossible to focus on a single competitor.
Yeah,
because everything simply doesn't have the weight of influence upon our lives, to drive something as drastic as evolution.
I also think it's more of just there is like a constant drive to fill a niche that doesn't, you know, necessarily exist yet, and you know, you don't necessarily have to be competing with someone to, you know, try to fill that niche, which is more fulfilling. Like, I guess it's the process of evolution is not designed. It's essentially, if there's a bunch of things competing for the same resources, only the ones who find new and unique ways of branching out and getting those resources in different and, you know, monopolizable ways, if that makes sense, will start to emerge as dominant over time. And that's in a very basic sense. But yeah. I guess the problem here is we don't know what the common ancestor of humans and
like a chimp is.
You know, other great apes were. So we can't study them. We don't know their diet, their habits. It's very... So,
like, I would argue
it's all speculation beyond, like, human ancestors, basically.
Yeah, because, like, I would argue that, like, all of the great apes, our niche is intelligence, period. Like, the great apes are smarter than the other ones. So, like, I would argue we did it best. But, like, it is also their niche, is to be cognitive, is to think. They don't have to think as hard, or given, like, and this is all very hypothetical, so I'm not going to do this for very long, but, like, the hypothetical argument there would be, okay, well, if humans aren't successful, what is to say that the chimp lineage doesn't make this leap too? Because I think now we're at a point in time where they are probably stunted, and without being kind of pushed, really, to make these, to have to make decisions like that, they'll never advance to a level of cognizance that we have.
Also, like, the answer is here a little bit. The chimp lineage did make that leap, and that's us, right? Because we're from a shared lineage. It's just we are.
Yeah, the theory.
Yeah, we are the smartest one. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. The theory here is that, you know, I talked a couple episodes back about, you know, the linear scaled primate brain theory. You know, it was by Susanna Herculano Hosel, I think that's how you say it. Basically, you know, the theory that our brains are like linearly scaled up from, you know, the standard primate like macaque or other medium-sized primate brain, where we preserved the brain function, but not like the body muscle mass function so much as where the other great apes decided to fill the niche of, you know, big body but less fully developed brain, because, you know, their neurons are less dense than ours, generally speaking. There are also like other like much smaller animals, much less complex animals who have more dense neurons than us, but their body sizes are much less. It's a very complicated thing, but basically you have to balance like the metabolic demands of having a big, strong, dense brain and having a big body that can physically obtain the things that it needs to fuel the brain. And where humans split off to prioritize the brain essentially and become a brain case, other great apes focused on, you know, using their body as a tool to, you know, survive. And I think we don't really give them enough credit. They have inhabited that niche for the entirety of history extremely well, longer than us, and they're very successful only recently because of our meddling in their natural habitat are they beginning to fail. And I guess that is, you could abstract that as a sort of evolutionary process where because we are now out competing them by taking their resources from them, you know, then maybe they're failed, basically. But it's also a matter of, is what we're doing natural? Which, you know, again, ties into, let's tie back into morality here.
And this is the argument, this is what the cognitive niche is. Humans developed this ability to use tools and to be cognitive agents in order to outpace evolution itself.
Yeah, whether on purpose or not. Like, the human invention of tools probably followed up by linguistics. It does exist as a feature of cheating death, of cheating that certain extinction, because a human without tool use and a human without language gets outcompeted by a chimp or a gorilla every time. We lack the physical strength, the physical stamina to really that life.
Stamina, one of the things that really
stamina has actually helped humans a lot.
Stamina is the reason we're able to ever get into the where we are, right? We just have to like put our heads down and keep moving forward at like literally just like out surviving other species just by sheer force of like stamina and will, which got us to a space
and also in a more literal sense where we used to literally run other animals to death, which is insane.
Last thing before we just go back to morality, because now I'm interested. Austin, in the last like 70 years since humans have really started knocking down the Congo, have we noticed a change in behavior in great apes like gorillas or chimps, like to try and adjust, to try and like evolve, I guess? Because I guess like our evolution is wildly faster than most other things have ever been.
Yep.
So like with our outside push, essentially, have we noticed a change in behavior of other great apes that are affected directly by it? Do we notice them acting differently, either doing more tool use, less tool use, are they being more complex or less complex, or are they just dying out?
It's a matter of what you consider to be more complex, or, you know, if this is just basic survival instinct, but all primates have adapted to human, like, there's basically an idea that there is no natural world anymore, and we can't, like, interfere with them because they're a part of our world now, whether they like it or not. And basically, primates have to adapt to fragmented habitats. They have to, you know, learn to steal from the trash of other humans. They have to learn...
Yeah.
Importantly, they have to learn to fear us because, especially if we're carrying guns, they have to learn that we are a predator. We are, you know, dangerous. Mm-hmm. But they also learn that, you know, we are a resource in many cases. For example, the temple monkeys of India and also most of the world, to be honest, wherever there's temples, they know that the temples are where they can go to get food and, you know, free food. And they can use that to sort of circumnavigate the tribulations of finding food in their natural environment, which is now massively depleted.
Yeah.
So...
And the use of the word adapt is important here because it's not evolution.
Yeah, it's not evolution.
It's not long enough.
At what point is it? At what point is it?
Until the timeline is long enough for it.
We won't. Humans won't live long enough to see that become evolution, in my opinion.
Yeah, that is. It is time and mutation. And there's no mutation. It's not long enough time. It is simply instincts being adaptable. Right, the same way a gazelle recognizes a big cat as a predator, it recognizes a human as a predator.
Mm-hmm.
You know, even though humans have changed our appearance as predators, you know, we go out in camo with guns.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's just it's an adaptation from instincts that they have already evolved.
I would argue genetically the changes would already exist though, because you can see like, and I know like humans maybe we are a bad case. Maybe we do. Like fundamentally evolve quicker. Maybe that is the thing. Maybe it's not the tool use or the language. It's some sort of mutation we have that allows us to genetically change ourselves quicker.
Because
a good example is trauma in a person. That will change not only your DNA, but your offspring's going forward. Like that is why intergenerational trauma exists. It is a genetic change.
Yeah.
There is like a noted genetic change. Like, so do we, and it's not a question you probably answer because we don't have the a sheet in front of us, but is that like, that's a change that is probably noted in other animals. So like, does that count as evolution?
So what you're getting into is called epigenetics, and it's the idea that most of our DNA is just sitting there, inactivated, useless, just spaghetti, basically.
Mm-hmm.
But certain physical changes in the environment, in the brain, in anything around us that we perceive can turn on these genes and either turn them on permanently or, you know, just temporarily, but... You know, if they're turned on permanently, they get passed on. And, you know, there's the idea that epigenetics can probably speed up evolution. Mm-hmm. But...
Like, so are we a case of epigenetics gone wild? Humans.
There is... We definitely have a lot of epigenetic shit going on. I haven't spent enough time on this in my undergrad, to be honest, to speak authoritatively on it. But I do know that this is something seen in... pretty much every animal, I think, but with humans, you know, it definitely could have played a factor in, you know, our evolution. So it's very hard to say, but it's called epigenetics. It's a whole field of study. It's very fascinating to look into.
I mean, you know what? If you're listening at home, motherfuckers, if you're at home right now and you're listening and you don't know what the fuck we're talking about, because this has been 45 minutes of us actually thinking, Google epigenetics. Google it.
Let's go back to morality.
To tie this back into morality.
Yeah.
I guess from here, this next thing I want to talk about, I'm going to just operate. Me personally, you guys don't have to. I'm going to operate on, let's say great apes have like a basic sense of some sort of morality. Otherwise, uh-huh. The next thing I want to talk about, it's going to be a lot more confusing to try and explain. So take everything I'm saying from here on out under the premise that I am assuming that a chimp or a gorilla may indeed have a basic sense of morality. Do we think they're capable of a spirituality? Do we think that like a human, why do we have an innate sense of spirituality? Part of it is because of our intelligence. We are trying to find a place for ourselves in the world, in a world where we are the only thing that we can communicate with. We are the only thing we can talk to. And so we have to ask ourselves, and we've been asking ourselves this question for 200 or 300,000 years now, is where do we fit? What is the reason that we exist? What is the reason we fit here? And why am I so smart? I think that's a real question that all of us ask ourselves. Just we put a lot of layers of shit on it now.
Yeah.
Why am I so smart if there is no reason to be? No obvious one.
So well, we talked about this just a moment ago, mm-hmm. about morality being defined by being watched, or like morality mm-hmm. being brought on by being watched.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was very interesting that chimps are non-moral agents, whatever that means, you know.
They're amoral.
They're amoral whenever they aren't being observed by their community. And I wonder if, I had this thought because I knew we were going to get to spirituality towards it in this episode,
mm-hmm.
does religion, do these spiritual systems function as a way to permanently keep the sense of community watching you? Ever present, and to guide you as a moral actor. And when Austin mentioned that chimps will exhibit, you know, moral agency with knowledge of being understood, being observed by the community.
I think that was great, but yeah.
you mentioned the chimp one specifically. You mentioned that chimps specifically do not engage with
them. Don't show.
That was my whole bit. Yeah, I'm so proud of Greg, actually.
I did research for this. I also have a point to make about linguistics and religion and morality.
But yeah, I think
I think that's a really cool theory, though, Chandran. Yeah.
Yeah, I think religion, I think spirituality serves.
Helps fill the niche.
Helps fill the niche, right?
I guess.
Helps keep us grounded.
I guess my only retort to that, only retort to that specifically would be, A, you have to explain atheism, not in like the, what's his name way, not in like the douchebag way, but also the fact that there are still societies that have nothing. There is no sense of that, no sense of spirituality. There's a couple, and there's one I read about. It was so fucking, when I was reading about linguistics, I learned a lot about these people. They live in the Amazon. There's only like 400 or 500 members of this community left. They speak a language that is non-recursive. So it's like the most basic form of language. It is literally a language of like grug, use rock. Like it is that basic. There are like two action words in the entire language. And they don't have any spiritual systems. There is no concept of spirits, of gods, a pantheon, even believing in like a spirits of the nature around them. They don't have that. And they do still function under this same kind of morality system. And the understanding is, I think, historically...
I have an important question here.
Go ahead.
And I think this is going to get maybe to my point here. Go ahead. Does the society have complicated tool use to the level that we do?
Absolutely. Americans? Yes.
They do.
Yes, they have the same level of tool use.
Have the same capacity for intelligence.
Yeah, so that's the thing. They have complicated tool use and architecture. Like, they were living... You can think of them as living as like an uncontacted tribe in the Amazon. It's like a hut, but they have they have bows and arrows. They had all the same tools like your average indigenous South American Amazonian tribe would have. They simply have almost no culture. They have like almost no culture to speak of. Period. They don't do ceremonies. They don't have a religion, any to speak of. They only had words for two colors when they were first contacted. They literally could only do green and blue. They did not, when they were presented, they had the other colors in the natural world. They just didn't have a word for them. So they would always be described as like blue light. Like it would be like, and they'd have combinations of words, but they never thought to invent more.
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
So
I mean,
they didn't need to.
We can look at English, like old English literature, and recognize like the colors we're using here are off. Why do we
use calling
this thing purple? But it's because they didn't have like
a word.
The proper word for the color that we have now.
Yeah.
And so I think my idea, which I don't know, we can discuss if this is maybe a valid idea or not, is religion itself a tool? Can we think of spirituality as a tool, and that these uncontacted, like some of these uncontacted tribes, or these tribes who have like a different, like whose language have not like permitted them to reach where we are? Because
I think we're going to differ philosophically here.
We might.
I think my personal relationship with it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I mean, to be clear, like I don't even want to say like these aren't even really my beliefs. I'm a very spiritual person. I believe it is that thing that exists, that unknowable, unmaterial thing. But however, when we're thinking about it in this perspective right now,
So I think like it's good that you're using that because I'm not gonna at all. I'm gonna. I am like very much a person who thinks that like. I don't want to be like, I believe in God.
No, I do it.
But more, it's more of like from an agnostic perspective that leans towards there is more than just what we can see.
Okay.
That there is more to it. That there is more to existence, period. All right. Whether that means we are part of a living machine that is the universe. Whether that means there is something. Like your consciousness can move. And I did a lot of research on that too while I was doing this. Was looking into near-death experiences. I read probably 40 different fucking articles about near-death experiences.
Good God.
And one thing that is interesting is that cross-culturally and throughout recorded history where these are recorded, they are always the same. irregardless of the faith, the only things that seem to change when it comes to the faith is the names that the people will give for things.
Yeah.
Or the faces that they're putting to things, or maybe like a physical description of what happens at the very end of their NDE. So the near-death experience is generally always described as a bright light and moving forward. That is a cross-cultural constant, is a bright light and moving, feeling of physically being pulled forward. Usually there are loved ones, relatives, some of which, one interesting thing that I came across in a bunch was they would be speaking with relatives or friends who had died that the person having that experience did not know they were dead.
Oh.
So that's a common thing. Others is like relatives, close people, and sometimes people that they don't know at all, but that they feel some sort of connection to. Not necessarily like, oh, I'm seeing a dead, you know, Robert Redford's ghost. More like they feel like this is a person who I'm related to. I just don't know who they are.
Yeah.
It like, and generally that's cross-cultural. You see it in Hindu people who have this experience, Muslims, Jews, Catholics, even, and it's harder to get these experiences from places where this isn't studied. So you have a lot, like you get a lot more from India, which is kind of the only like South Asian place you're going to get this catalog. We know it's happened in very sparse cases from what's been written down in other places like Indonesia and Vietnam. These have been written down. Native American cultures have this too. We've seen it. We've had it recorded, and they have, obviously it's their own cultural hallmarks plastered on top. So I guess that's, I don't know what the fuck the original point I was making was.
Well, no, it's interesting. I think we were.
Uh-huh.
Let's bring this back to primates. Let's deconstruct what Coco the gorilla said when asked about what she thinks is going to happen after she dies. Now, assuming that this wasn't like a coached answer, or that she wasn't like, you know, basically trained to think a certain way beforehand, which basically she was. But let's think about this for a second. Coco the gorilla's response to where she's going to go after she dies was comfortable, whole, bye. There's the idea of comfort and whole, which I think the whole is alluding to burial, which I think is pretty obviously something that was coached by humans, but comfortable, I don't know if that's something that can even be like...
it's a complex thought.
Yeah, I don't know how that could be coached necessarily. So I don't know, like, is there something there, or is that just completely, you know, confirmation bias, training, so on and so forth?
I think it's confirmation bias. I think it's incredibly hard to ask that question. Not even on the linguistic level, like that is obviously already incredibly difficult, or maybe a moral level, that's also incredibly difficult. I think on an emotional level, for an animal that is as complex, let's say, as Coco, as a gorilla, bonobo, chimp, that is complex enough to understand these things, but not put the... They lack the words. They literally lack the way to get it out, to explain. Because they do show the ability, obviously, to grieve. Like, we know that they grieve. We know they feel bad, but they're not the only animals that do. There are much less complex animals that seem to show this capacity, which to me proves a whole different point. But specifically, like, it's... I don't know. If you could give... If, like, we could bring Coco back from the dead and give her the chip that lets her speak English, like, what is she actually trying to say?
Yeah.
Like, what is actually attempting to be communicated? Because even for... A gorilla, they asked the damn gorilla this, like, not too soon, before she died. Like, you also can't really know, we don't even know if, but we don't know if she was experiencing any sort of internal turmoil, knowing that she was getting sicker, or like, you know, like, even a person knows when they're getting close. Yeah. So we don't know if there was, we don't know if they're capable, A, of that emotional turmoil that obviously comes with aging and passing away. But we also don't know if there's, like, what it, like, a comfortable hole. Goodbye. That's a physical description. It's not necessarily, like, an answer we want. So, yeah.
Yeah.
It's a physical description of what's going to happen, which is interesting that she even considered you get buried. Because gorillas don't do that in the wild, right? Where are the dead gorillas? How come you never see any of those?
Well,
we don't really hang out where the gorillas are.
Yeah, but they just die and they lay in there. Like, why don't we go?
That was my question for Austin. What do they do with their dead?
Yeah. So there's a couple of things to cover here. Basically, I think it's very similar to what humans used to do before the advent of, I guess, to call it crudely, the death industry, where basically humans used to take care of the dead. They used to wash them. They used to, you know, take care of the bodies, clean them of bugs and stink. And so do other primates. They take care of the bodies. They have an ownership, a community ownership of the body, where if human caretakers try to come in and take a dead chimpanzee, they get, like, outraged. It's like, what are you doing? We're taking care of him. He's dead now. They don't really understand what we're going to do with it, and what we're doing has no meaning to them, obviously, like burying the chimp. But basically, usually what happens, especially in the case of mothers and dead infants, is carrying around and taking care of the body for as long as possible until it either... it's hard to say what the breaking point is for them, where it's either not recognizable or not salvageable anymore, basically. And at that point, they move on. And it's a matter of, you know, is something forcing them to move on, or have they moved on mentally, like, from the grief? Are they ready to move on? So,
Do we see it's a variable time length between, like, mothers?
It's definitely variable. Like, there's been some who will carry around a dead monkey until it's completely unrecognizable, basically. But yeah, there's a lot of interesting things, like, this also comes down to a debate between Japanese primatology and Western primatology, as it's called, where Japanese primatology is based on the idea that you have to sympathize with these animals because this can't be a purely empirical science. You have to try to sort of use some subjectivity to the description of the behaviors you see, whereas Western science tries to
be completely objective.
Divorce itself from anthropomorphizing primates and just sort of stick to purely recordable data, pretty much. For example, I guess to go back to what you were saying about near-death experiences, you know, there's explanations where, you know, the brain is trying to prevent panic in its final moments by flooding the nervous system with all sorts of chemicals, so on and so forth. It's reliving memories to try to, you know, figure out a solution, a last-minute solution. And there's also, you know, with primates, we don't know how they feel. We can't know how they feel for sure. But, you know, one thing people do in captivity is try to measure the amount of cortisol, I think.
Yeah.
I think it might be
cortisol. Something. It's a stress hormone.
Yeah, it is cortisol, yeah. But yeah, I think it's something hormone. More specific they look for. But anyways, stress hormones, they try to measure the amount in, you know, hair samples and feces samples and urine samples, blood even. And they use that as a sort of indicator of well-being. But it's still hard to tell because, you know, there's even a big debate on, is pacing back and forth a symbol of, you know, bad welfare? Because they will see this behavior in macaques, for example, captive macaques in research, where they're just pacing back and forth, and they're like, well, something's clearly wrong, but they'll take a, you know, cortisol test, basically, and they won't find anything wrong. And they're like, well, he's not stressed. There's nothing, like, physically wrong with him. He's just doing that. But he looks stressed, right? So there's a big disconnect in what you can quantify and what you can qualify.
I guess, like, my point with that, because I didn't actually know that they did that, that they would A, carry them around, and B, like, take care of the body. Yeah. I think, like, to me, like, that shows a very primitive sense of some sort of spirituality, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. That shows some sort of sense of spirituality. Now,
I think in my perspective, I think this is almost like proof positive that great apes are stuck with a material understanding of these things. They don't have our abstract, our immaterial sense of death. I think so. Because what we do with bodies now, because Austin, you said early humans would do the same thing, right? We take care of them.
Yeah, I mean, even like up until recently in our culture, like before it became like a whole industry to sell caskets and, you know, what's the chemical they put in people to preserve them? That thing.
Formaldehyde.
Yeah.
Yeah. Basically, even before that, it was sort of standard procedure. Like before any of the rituals of your respective religion, to take care of the body and get your final goodbyes in, but like to continue caring for them. But it's not hard to imagine that's what the entirety of early human post-death care looked like. But, you know, we do have, obviously, proof of burials and stuff like that, so...
Mm-hmm. We have burials and grave goods, and I think grave goods are very important to this conversation, specifically. So we
found early human ancestors that would actually take... The way we found some certain human ancestors was because they were preserved very well in cave systems. And what that showed us was that early human ancestors used to take the dead bodies of, you know, family members or community members and hide them somewhere and, you know, put them where they weren't obtainable, which there's a theory of, is that the beginnings of ritual or is that just... hiding the bodies from predators to prevent them from, like, locating the other members of the species. So there's a debate there.
That is interesting. But to go back to grave goods real quick.
Yeah, sorry.
Do we know, like, because I know it's, like, very, very rare. It's very rare for in the wild for a researcher to stumble across a dead chimp or a dead gorilla. Because they generally are kind of, they're out there, but they're hidden away. So, of the ones that we have that we have found, I don't even know if we have found any. Do the other animals leave things there, even if that's just a stick or a rock? Like, do we?
Or just like some berries?
Yeah, have we noticed that? Because we have noticed that in other entirely different species, whereas like elephants will do that. They will leave the grave. They will leave. And they've been known to even kind of bury their dead. We've known that they will leave and come back for years later to be there, to be at that specific spot where they put their dead family member, they put their dead community member, and leave them. They'll leave things there over and over and over again for years, knowing that it is, obviously they have a very intense caloric intake they need to meet every day. They're taking time out of that to do something that is strictly emotional. So have we noticed that kind of behavior in apes outside of ourselves?
Unfortunately, the closest thing we have witnessed, now this was witnessed relatively recently in 2017, so who's to say that there's not more that we're missing in certain chimp groups, but for example, basically the prime example of funerary rites is that chimps will clean the corpses of dead chimps, but that's where it stops to our knowledge. But it's possible there's more, but we not that we've seen. But
okay. I'm wondering now if our conversation on spirituality is kind of paralleling our conversation on morality, where we are once again having to consider, did these instincts and rituals come first and then grow into spirituality? Or has the rapid mutation of humans turned these instincts into spiritual systems alongside our, you know, linguistic and moral systems?
I don't know.
I don't know. That's a good
question. It's hard to it's hard to ask because our evolution is so jumbled. Like, does it?
Yeah.
Do we do these things first and then they become ingrained in our in our evolution? Mm-hmm. Do we do these things truly at the beginning?
Yeah.
Do we do them first purely out of an emotional sense and then it becomes part of us through repetition? Mm-hmm. Or do we think... Go ahead. You're good.
I feel like the linguistic community has pretty solidly settled that these are not like our language did not evolve from slow usage over time developing into language. It has been almost, I don't want to say like 100%.
I want to say, you're right. The growing, the dominant theory is they just like, it's a switch.
It is rapid mutation. It is a switch. This is for, like, this is basically what is accepted by linguists. I think this is a clever thing we are doing, that we are connecting these three things together. I think morality and spirituality, if at all, that's also the thing, right? I'm genuinely very spiritual. In like a way that even like further than you, Greg. Like I have
Sam, you're trying to like spirit log. Yeah, like, fuck you, Greg.
I went up on your ass. But like generally have like codified stories and beliefs and things that I believe in.
Well, I have those too. I was toning it down for this. Just to stab back.
Okay, I see.
We're gonna have a god off.
But yeah, I think so. I mean, there is always the answer that we can't really fall back on in this conversation, that it does not matter physiologically because it doesn't exist materially.
Yeah, exactly.
None of this exists materially. We will never have an answer because
there's only one. You get one chance at answering it, and there's a 50-50 shot.
Yep.
You get one. This one answer. So.
Uh huh.
Yeah, so, I think it's interesting. And I wonder if maybe...
Like, you know the answer for like half of a second and then you're done. It's off. Yeah.
I think... Okay, Richard Dawkins.
Epic Reddit atheist.
You are, though. Another good question is, do these systems... Like, obviously language is the most important factor, I think, in communicating these and in expanding upon them more than just a base feeling. Is if we could give like a great ape language tomorrow, do they have these thoughts that they can't put to words? They can't put to a like they're clearly capable of complex thought. They're just not capable of projecting a complex thought out into the world around them.
Yeah, I think
so. Like that's I think is a really important piece of that.
I think if I were to answer this from like a spiritual perspective, I would say if all of God's creations could speak tomorrow, you know, they would sing his praises, right? but from like a material perspective, I don't think so. I don't think if you gave animals speech overnight that they would.
I would have to change something fundamental about the way their brain works, and then would they still even be that?
Have animal? The same thing, yeah. I guess my idea would be just from I'm taking it from a different angle than I think you are, Austin, like observing them do certain things with their dead. Like, I think my argument would be if they could talk tomorrow, I think they would have a deeper concept of it than I think we give credit for.
Yeah.
I really do. And I don't know if that concept is so much whether it would be epic Reddit atheism or it would be like chimp not here anymore, chimp gone, chimp somewhere else. I like if that would be the concept is their conceptualization of it, if they could put the words to it, that animal is now somewhere else or that they are gone. I think that's really the only question to ask is, do you think that they're gone or do you think that they are somewhere?
Yeah. And I think we are closing in on time here, so I guess the answer here is there will literally never be almost definitely never be an answer to this, just because from what the tools available to us right now, we know that they don't have the capacity to communicate these things, and they would have to change fundamentally in order for that to happen. Mm-hmm. So we can't know, we will never know, and it
until
sucks
you
and it's frustrating.
Individually die, you will not know.
That's really the
and that's true for
and even as well. Even taking like all like the near death experience example, like
I was more speaking to the not knowing how the chimps are thinking. But
but I think to speak to this is like to put it very plainly, like you have two options, irregardless of there being hundreds of like the same experience, you still have two options. Your two options are, it's a massive flood of DMT, and for some reason. We all imagine it the same. Second answer is you kind of just take it and say, okay, that's what's happening. Like, but there is no third, like you pick. And it's kind of the same with the chimps. You kind of have to just go, yeah, they probably have a concept of something, or they don't. That's what you would have to ask.
Yeah.
I want to finish that thought, Austin.
But, I don't know. This has been
part two.
This has been a very long, very interesting for us. I don't know. Let us know if this is interesting for you guys.
Yeah, let us know if this is interesting, because this is the first episode we've ever done where we didn't
jokes. We made a little bit of joke.
We made jokes.
This
the first
is just
5 minutes.
A straight like stoner weed circle jerking off about philosophy classes we haven't really taken. That kind of shit. We love it. We love to see it in podcasts.
Next
let us
week
know
we're
if
reading
this sucks ass or not.
We're getting to the materialist shit, motherfucker.
Once again, if this is good, keep subscribing. If this is bad, send a bomb to Greg's house or mine if you can find it.
Not mine.
Mill Creek,
though.
Utah. Anyway, so while we wrap it up, let's do some of our normal shtick. I would like to thank some of our newest patrons. I'm going to read off a bunch.
Absolutely.
I read you last
got
time.
A lot
congratulations.
Of
I read you last
love
time.
Love you all.
Again, I won't read last names. If I read your name and you don't like that I did that, go ahead and fucking let me know somehow. New subscribers, Duncan,
shout
Ignis,
out. Hell yeah.
Skogs My Roar. Poltergeist, who we've been seeing you in the Twitch, so shout out.
And in the Discord now.
And in the Discord, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to read your whole name. Robin, the non-binary blunder. That's a great one.
Okay. more non-binary fans. Love that.
Yeah. Shout out Darby.
Fuck out Darby.
Yeah, I'm just scrolling around now. Shout out Sophie, Tasha, Madeline, and Katie. Thank you guys so much for being subscribers.
Yeah.
If you're not a subscriber and you like content like this, go ahead and subscribe. You probably won't get anything like this again, but go ahead and subscribe. We got a lot of cool content. You probably might, though. We might. Maybe we'll expand
upon
this,
crazy
but Patreon only.
We'll get silly with it.
Mm-hmm? Maybe we do more of this, but it'll only be on Patreon. Because it is a very long and draggy thing, so.
Yeah, it's an acquired taste. If you hate it,
we'll
get back
also,
to our normal monkey business.
Yeah. Also, I just want to let everybody know. Go ahead. I don't know the fucking link to it. We moved our merch store. We have more products, and we've got our new winter collection line out.
Oh hell yeah!
Go ahead and go on any of our socials. Click on our link tree. Click on the merch store. All kinds of cool shit. We are running
a
deal until the end of the month. I don't remember what the fucking code is. It's 5% off.
It's Travis.
It's
Travis.
It's code Travis. Code Travis. 5% off on any of your orders. Order some shit. We got cool stuff. We've made our designs a lot better. And
I made the Xanax chimp design.
Yeah, we've got Travis the Xan chimp.
Folks, you can go to any of our socials and find our link tree, like Greg just said.
Yeah.
But I'm going to say it out loud so y'all can have it. Patreon.com/GorillaRadioShow. You can go subscribe at any of the tiers, get our bonus content for merch. And I just want to shout the fuck out Greg, who's in here in the fucking trenches, making
slaving away,
paving a way for y'all to give y'all this shit. It is at Gorilla Radio Show.
Tooth and nail with customer service representatives.
It is at gorillaradioshow.myshopify.com. You know what? In the future, we're going to probably buy a domain just to put everything there. We're going to say, hey, go to this URL and you'll see everything. But that day is not today. So, one more time, patreon.com/gorillaradioshow, gorillaradioshow.myshopify.com.
Yo,
anyway, thank you for listening.
Give me a fucking follow on my public Twitter account.
Give the others
Swamp
some clout.
Greg, okay? You can follow Austin at Piss Vortex. I'm sure you already do. You can follow us, our podcast on Twitter at gorilla_radio. And Chandra, I don't know your at.
We got to upgrade that.
I'm on Twitter at Moon's Gift.
Give us a fucking follow. Shout us out. Don't worry, soon, guys, the Gorilla Radio Show Twitter account will be verified for $8 a month.
No, paying Elon.
I will be doing nothing but tweeting this information under the auspices of the NASA Twitter account. So, good luck, everyone. Shout out.
Yeah, we killed those chimps. We fucking liked it.
Exactly.
We blew them up.
Let's do our first episode, Apes in Space. Great episode.
I'm going to start tweeting as the ghost of Ham the chimp. No. Shout out. This has been great. This is a good episode.
All right. Yeah. We had fun, at least. That's all that matters.
Exactly.
That is all that matters.
Freeloading.
This is just a fucking vanity project. Okay.
Yeah, for sure. Okay. Anyway, bye. We'll see you next time later in the month. Bye.
Bill Nye the Science Guy. Science guy.